Welcome. It's great to have you in service today. If you are visiting with us, there are some visitor cards in the pew in front of you. I'd love for you to take it out, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by so that next week through the mail, we'll send you information about New Hope. We promise not to beat on your door, not to bother you on the phone. We have room for two up here on the fourth row, right here. If you got room for two, fourth row, right here. Just my first career was at a movie theater, and we're good at that. Actually, perfect timing for the Butterfields. We had a great opportunity to spend some time with them this week. As many of you know, their son, Tony Butterfield, was killed overseas. Okay, Iraq and Afghanistan conflict, war. And they honored him this week, all right? And he's by the Great American Car Wash, has this big, gigantic three-wall mural. And Tony's face was added to that this past week, and they had a dedication of that. So we got to share with them this week in our small group. So that was great fun. You guys know the car wash I'm talking about? Great American Car Wash on Blackstone, just north of Dakota. Okay, it's on the east side of the street. If you've never been by there, it's kind of out of my driving range, but I'll go there more often now. But go by and look at the mural, even if you don't need your car washed. All right, it's just an incredible thing, a tribute that they've done to law enforcement as well as to our soldiers. And it's worth the time to go by and take a look at it. I've written out my announcement. We got a lot to cover today, so I'm going to get on target and on task here, okay? When you leave today, remember this service, it's great to go out these two doors. I know it's so close to that one, but if you can, head out these two because the next service will be coming in back there. Also, there are things out in the pavilion that you may not know, I may forget to announce, you need to see. Plus, there's free coffee, and you never know when there'll be donut holes out there as well, all right? So great for you to go out to the pavilion. It's why we put it there. There are several things on the pavilion for you to see. Number one, the pasta feed tonight. All right? If you haven't got your ticket for the pasta feed, $6, all the pasta you can eat and salad. And then there's also going to be raffle giveaways. All right? There are gift baskets and there are gift cards to great restaurants in town. And you can get a raffle ticket for $1 a ticket. Or you can buy a string of raffle tickets as tall as you are for $20. Okay? So, Chick, I would suggest you just pay $1 a ticket, all right? You'll be ahead, all right? Or you all can give your money to Tim Belcher, all right? And let Tim Belcher buy your tickets for you, all right? But $20 for as tall as you are, and you can get that out in the pavilion after the service today. Change for Baby bottles is out there. If you didn't pick yours up on Mother's Day, you pick up an empty baby bottle. Between now and Father's Day, fill it with loose change, bring it back. And it goes to support for the Pregnancy Care Center. All right, change for baby bottles. Aviation in Action also has a table out there. Banquet tickets are available for June the 14th. And as you know, Mark Addis is the one who founded this ministry. It's just getting off the ground. And it helps in a variety of different ways. Medical transportation for emergencies. It's helping in mission. We hope that we'll have our first opportunity in Africa, possibly with a helicopter next February, and all kinds of ways in which they are being used to expand the kingdom of God. So that banquet is on the 14th of June. Tim Kepler has got CDs available out there today. He's done that a couple of years ago. People have been asking, can he bring them back again? He did, and he's doing it for a particular reason today. As you know, he also has his own ministry called From Fulsome to Forgiven Foundation. If you're new to New Hope, you might not realize this guy with a beautiful voice and a handsome face. He spent some time behind prison walls at Folsom. He got his life right with the Lord 20 years ago. Right, Tim? 21? 21 years ago. I knew he was back there somewhere. And he's been walking with the Lord, and God has used him in great ways. That's how we met, was behind prison walls, sharing together in a prison outreach with Prison Fellowship. And he is doing a yard event at L.A. County Jail. Okay, kind of like the yard events you've heard us talk about that we have shared in the various prisons here in the valley. They are doing it at County Jail. In L.A. County, there are 20,000 incarcerated at the county jail. And so they're going to do a yard event. He's bringing in guests, musicians, worship team, comedians, speakers, and his organization is doing this, From Folsom to Forgiven. So every CD that you purchase today, those resources are going to fund that event. It's about a $5,000 event. Some of you say, well, Tim, I've already got a CD. Then just write a check from Folsom to Foundation, hand it to them, all right, as you go out there today, and it will go towards that event. We would love for you to help them. The goal is $5,000. I would love for that just to be finished today. That would just be grand, all right? So think about it as you leave here today. Announcements now. Celebrate Recovery is having a concert here in the sanctuary this Thursday night. This coming Thursday night, Heather Lane, you'll see her poster on the doors as you go out both directions. She has a lovely voice. She's not bad to look at, that poster indicates anyway. She has an incredible testimony, and so she's kind of swinging for the fences there, all right? She understands Celebrate Recovery, and she's going to share her testimony, but more importantly, she's going to sing about what her faith in Christ has done for her. So come, and that is this coming Thursday evening. What time is it?
6:30 concert.
All right, 6:30 concert. Next Sunday afternoon from 4 to 5:30, also right here in the sanctuary, is going to be music time, hymn sing. Randy Berger on the piano, and Debbie Blankenship on the flute, and Gene Sperling behind the mic, and a lot of request time. All right, so from 4 to 5:30 here at the church. June 1st, 2 weeks from today, the Actus family will be home from Columbia for 6 weeks. All right? This is big, guys. Those of you who are newer to our church, you may not know how big this is, so let me give you just a short version of it. The Actus family were part of our church family, all right, for 4 years before they left to Columbia. He was a school teacher at Clovis East High School. Great at what he did. Four beautiful daughters, all right? And they went on a mission trip, and they went on a second mission trip, and they went on a third mission trip, and then they called and said, "Can we come visit with you?" And they said, "We think God is calling us to full-time mission work. And we don't care where he sends us, just not Columbia." He sent them to Columbia. They're happy to be there. They're doing a great, great work there. But guys, here's the deal for us New Hope family. 4 years ago, we made a 4-year commitment to them. That's how faith promises work for missionaries, all right? It's a 4-year term. We made a commitment. Next month, if you've been giving us all 4 years, you will have fulfilled your commitment. But the Actus commitment is not up. Their commitment to God was indefinitely. Okay? 4 years at a time, but they've committed until God closes that door. So all of us who have supported them the past 4 years, I trust God will direct you and you will listen to sign up for the next 4 years. Okay? There'll be faith promise cards that will be passed out on June the 1st. We'll pass them out for every Sunday in the month of June. All right? And you can take them, fill them out, bring them back to us. We'll collect them every Sunday in June. All right? Some of you who are new, once you hear the Actuses, you'll hear their presentation on June 1st. They'll share what they've been doing the last 4 years. They will also preach that Sunday morning. All right? In all of our services, you'll get a chance to meet them and connect with them. I hope those of you who've never met them before will consider a faith promise card. And what that means is above and beyond what you do to New Hope, you're going to say, "Hey, God willing, we're going to give $20 a month for the next 4 years to the Actuses. $10 a month, $50 a month, whatever it is." But it's all of those little pieces coming together, God uses. Our goal is $15,000 cash and $7,000 a month in faith commitments. Okay? Now, all that doesn't have to come from New Hope. There are other churches that support them, but we are their home church. When they left 4 years ago, it was $60,000 that we raised, and we did it in 7 months. Okay? And it was $6,000 of support that was raised. So, $45,000 less on the cash in, $1,000 more on the monthly support, piece of cake, right? As all of us chip in, we can do that, all right? So they're coming, be praying for their return, and look forward. Now, the last Sunday they're here, they're going to be with us on Sunday evening. We're going to ordain Matt in ministry. He's not ordained, so we're going to have an ordination service. You probably haven't seen very many of those, all right? We've done 3 in the 21 years I've been here at New Hope. So we're going to be ordaining Matt in a special service that evening, and we're going to have a potluck time, potluck dessert afterwards. And so time for you guys to visit, and we're going to count up the pledges and the cash. And then they're leaving 2 days later. So we hope we have it all right? It'll be exciting. So that's coming up June the 1st. June the 1st is also our homeless outreach. That afternoon, if you took a grocery bag a few weeks ago, bring that grocery bag filled with the groceries from the list that was in it. This year, we're going to be engaged in 2 more sermon series. All right, we're going to start one on Father's Day. You ready, men? We're going to kick off on Father's Day. It's going to be called 40 Days to a Healthier Life, Body, Soul, and Spirit. 40 Days to a Healthier Life. We're going to look at faith and focus and friends and food and fitness. All right, We're going to cover the whole thing. The Bible says that our bodies are what? The living tabernacle, the living temple of God. All right? So we're going to talk about body, soul, and spirit, how we can be as healthy as we possibly can be. And we're going to look, the 40 days is kind of a significant time for a lot of things in the Bible, and we're going to discover why. So we will launch that on Father's Day. We're going to come to the end of summer, and we are going to be in the best all-around shape we have ever been in. This is not about losing weight. So those of you who are saying, oh, I'm not coming to church. Well, he talks about, no. It's about being spiritually, physically, emotionally, mentally healthy. All right? So 6 weeks we'll be doing that. Then, stationary bikes. Yeah, stationary bikes. Then we're going to launch the middle of August once back to school kicks off. The sequel to the series called The Story. Remember we did that 2.5 years ago? The Story? Sequel is coming out next year. It's called Believe. We get to be on the uncutting edge. It's uncutting because it's not out yet. We were selected to be one of 30 churches across the United States that gets to work with the authors and Zondervan Publishing Company to fine-tune this series called Believe. And so we are going to launch our Sunday school program, our adult ministry, our Sunday morning sermons. For 30 weeks, we'll all be on the same page, just like we were with the story. The theme is this. You read the story? Now live the story. And the 30 weeks are 3 10-week segments. The first 10-week segment are the key truths of the Bible, the key truths that we build our life on this rock that we build our life. The next 10 weeks are on the key practices of the Bible, the key practices that God has given to the church and his family in terms of how we live. And the last 10 weeks are on the key attributes to the Christian life. Basically, it's the fruit of the Spirit, how Christ reveals himself through us. So 10, 10, and 10. And by the way, 10 is the number of completeness in the Bible as well. So we will complete those 3 10s. All right, prayer concerns. This one is a praise item and a prayer concern. Marilyn, would you stand up, please? Marilyn Choate, she has been with us for a few years now. And here's what's exciting. When she first came here, she would have never done that. She would have not even stood up, but she would have said, don't say a word. Marilyn has come to discover Christ in her time here. She has grown in her faith and her walk with the Lord. She's been part of a small group. She has flourished and blossomed and been nourished, and she's made a decision that she could not have made 3 years ago. She is stepping out, moving to a new area, going to have new friends, and find a new church family, and she's going to continue to grow in her relationship with the Lord. So give her a round of applause. Say thanks for being part of our church family, and we will be praying for her. God bless you, dear. We're going to miss you. Come back often. Amen. All right, Marilyn. Great. We're praying for you, girl. Frank Hicks, as you know, had open heart surgery 2 weeks ago. He is now at Golden Living Center, which is on Barstow off of Minnewaba, going through a few more days of recuperation. So be praying for him. He hopes to go home soon. Captain Joe Powers. Marcella sitting right here on the fourth row in her regular seat. Captain Joe Powers, as you know, had been in a rest home, looking forward to going home. Well, he relocated yesterday at 4:15. He relocated to the streets of gold in a city not built by man's hands to a room that Jesus had just finished for him. And so he is now in heaven this morning. He was 94 years young here on earth, and he's now eternally young as he is in heaven. I'll be meeting with Marcella and Joe's son Joe. This afternoon, and we'll have plans. You can call the office, and we'll let you know when the services are going to be for Captain Joe. Please be praying for Marcella and for their son. They would appreciate that so very much. James Lewandowski. Lewandowski, part of the clan, is here. Wave. You always know when they're here. They're a big family, both in height, number, size. I know Tim Hurt's here somewhere. Back Tim, where are you? Window. Oh, he's back there in the window. All right. Be praying for them. His father-in-law had triple bypass surgery. He went in for a little balloon procedure. And it turned into triple bypass surgery the following day. He's doing well. And God spoke to him pretty strongly. So that was rather exciting. Jerry Lewis from our church is going to have some cleanup on his hip replacement he had done several years ago. He'll be in the hospital for about 3 days this week. The Claudia Glenn family, their service is tomorrow for Claudia. Claudia's son, Scott, he and his family own On the Edge Coffee Shop on Pulaski in the House of Juju. Restaurant on Pulaski, and so longtime Clovis families. Just found this out. Mary Beth Gammon had surgery this week, double mastectomy. She is home, so we want to be praying for Mary Beth and for the Gammon family. And then Spolstra's, wave, so everybody sees you. There we go. All right, we prayed for her husband last week. He went in to have surgery up in Northern California on his jaw. Surgery went well. They hope that all the results will come back clean and clear so that they can keep the portion of his jaw and they don't have to do a whole brand new one. So just be praying for God's best and his recovery as they go through that. So those are a few updates from last week. Now we're finished. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings. Let's pray. Our Father, we love you. We thank you for life and the privilege of sharing life with you. We thank you for the joy of your word and your truth, and may it speak to our hearts and challenge us today. Father, I trust in the preparation for this morning's message that I have surrendered my thoughts to your thoughts. And I trust, Father, I've given you a clear path to speak your truth to each of us today. I hope that Tim stays out of the way so that Jesus Christ is exalted, is lifted up, and his truth will be that which pierces our heart and makes a difference in our lives so that through us you can make a difference in the world. I trust you with the needs of hearts for care and comfort today. For Marcella, Lord, it's great to see her here this morning. There are some who would say there's no way I could be at church after a night like last evening, and Marcella's telling us there's no better place to be than with God's family at a time like this. Thank you for the example that she is revealing to us. Father, I trust you for her needs and the needs of their son, Joe. Thank you for a long life that you've given to Captain Joe, and thank you for the privilege you gave to New Hope for him to be a part of our fellowship. He's made a difference. Dear Father, for the Glenn family, we trust you for care. Most of his family knows you, so we know that they have your care and your comfort, but we just lift them up to you today. For those who've had surgeries from heart to jaw to lung, we commit their needs to cancer. We trust that their recoveries go very, very well. We trust you for the needs of their family during this time of recovery, and however you may use us, may you find us ready and available. Father, for the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thanks today. Father, we give not because we have to, not because we're forced to, not because we're commanded. We are challenged. Father, giving is a testimony that our faith is deep in you, that we believe you can do more with our less than we can do with our all. We have the example of a boy with a few loaves of bread and a couple of small fish, and with what was so small, you did so much. And so, Father, with our little, we'll be excited to see what great things you do for your kingdom work. We commit all this to you in the awesome, incredible name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. I invite you to turn your Bibles to the book of Colossians, chapter 3. A few minutes, we'll be focusing on verse 23. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Colossians 3, verse 23. I grew up as a kid listening to a story from my grandfather and my dad. I've told it here on a couple of occasions. It actually involved a great uncle of a member of our church here, Glenn Matson's uncle. His last name was Yandel. And he was a doctor, which was very unusual. This is, we're talking back in the 30s and the 40s. And Doc Yandel was a great mind and a great debater. And in the 30s and the 40s, you didn't get to go home on a Sunday afternoon and watch a baseball game or a football game. You didn't have TV. Best entertainment you had was the radio, and there wasn't a lot of programming on in those days. And so what often church people did is they went back to church. And on Sunday afternoons, they would have debates. All right, church in one neighborhood, the Presbyterians and the Baptists, and they would all meet in one church on a Sunday afternoon, and they would debate an area of doctrine that they differed in. And then they would take a vote, you know, and see which one won the debate that day. And sometimes those debates got pretty serious. And on one particular Sunday afternoon, Doc Yandel was debating with a Church of Christ pastor. And they were debating one of their differences in doctrine. And I guess both of these men were very, very passionate about their belief, and they were engaged in this very serious debate. And finally, it got so heavy that the Church of Christ pastor stood up, walked over the table where Doc Yandel, and he slugged him. I tell you what, that was the best entertainment they'd had in a long, long time at one of those events. And Doc Yandel picked himself up off the ground, and he stood up, and he looked at the other preacher, and he said, "My Bible tells me I'm supposed to turn the other cheek." And so we turned the other cheek. And that Church of Christ pastor slugged and hit him in the other cheek, knocked him down again. Doc Yandel was a big man. And he gets up and he quoted Colossians 3:23. In the King James, it says, whatever your hand findeth to do, do it with all your might. And he picked up a chair and he knocked it over his head. End of debate. Now that's being pretty passionate, all right, about something. And that's really what we're going to look at, is either finding or reigniting our passion for the things of God. You see, the creative force behind all great art or drama or music or architecture or writing, the driving force, is passion. Nothing great is ever accomplished in someone's life without great passion. Nothing great is ever sustained in life without great passion. Passion is that which energizes life. Passion makes the impossible possible. Passion gives us a reason to get up in the morning and say, I'm going to do something with my life today. Did you do that this morning? Did you wake up, put your feet on the floor, and look at the world and say, I'm going to do something with my life today? My life is going to count for something this day. Or did you get up and say, oh crap, I got to go to church. Or that might have been, oh me, all right? You see, without passion, life becomes boring. Without passion, it becomes monotonous. It's routine. It's dull. God created us with emotions to have passion in our life, and He wants us to live this life with great passion. Passion is what mobilizes armies into action. It's what causes explorers to boldly go where no man has gone before. Passion is what causes scientists to stay up late at night trying to find the cure for a dreaded disease. Passion is what takes a good athlete and turns him or her into a great athlete where they're breaking records. Passion will enable us to do what we would never do if we didn't have it. We must have passion in our life. May I suggest to you, it is passion that will drive you to your knees. Bless you. However, I think you can have a little more passion in that sneeze. It is passion that will pause us long enough in a busy life to hit our knees and pray for our kids who aren't walking with God, for our spouse whose heart has grown cold, for our neighbor who we have never met, but we know if there's not a change in their life, they have no chance of being our neighbor in heaven. Passion. One day a man walks up to Jesus and says, Lord, what's the most important thing in the scriptures? What's the most important thing in the Word of God? And you know what the great commandment is. Those of you who've been at New Hope long enough, we've talked about it on several occasions. Jesus says, I want you to love God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, and with all of your strength. I want you to love God with your entire being. Nothing matters more than that. Jesus said to that man that day, the number one thing is life, is I want you to love me passionately. Nothing else matters in life if we don't love God passionately. God doesn't want us to love Him half-heartedly. The Bible describes that in the book of Revelation, a love that is lukewarm. And do you know what God does with a lukewarm love? He goes, you keep laughing, I'm going to keep doing it, okay? That's what he says. He said, that's how I value, oh love, that is just lukewarm. I love the paraphrase out of Mark chapter 11, verse 30, from a Bible called The Message. And it says it this way. Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all of your passion and your prayer and your intelligence and your energy. If you had your Bible and it happened to be a message, I would say circle that word passion. For the word in Greek for passion is the word heart. And God is saying, I want you to put some muscle into it. Give it some energy. Put some emotion in your relationship with me. Don't be a wimp about your relationship. Don't be namby-pamby. Don't be half-hearted. Give it all you've got. Jesus is saying, if you're going to follow me, you got to go with passion. You got to give it some oomph, some spark, some zippity-doo-dah. Where are you? There we are. Bruce knows what I'm talking about. Some zippity-doo-dah in this thing. Some zest. He says, I want you to live passionately. in the relationship you have with me. In fact, this truth of passion is found throughout the Bible. The Bible tells us that we are to seek God passionately. We are to love God passionately. The Bible says that we are to serve and obey God passionately. We're to trust Him passionately. Then if you don't get the message, in Colossians 3:23, it says, whatever you do, what's left out? Anything left out in that? No. Whatever you do, do it with how much? All of your heart, as unto the Lord and not unto men. He says, I want you to do everything passionately when it comes to loving me, serving me, living for me, trusting me. Here's the amazing thing. In this country, in the good old US of A, it's okay to be passionate about anything and everything except God. It's not politically correct to be passionate about God. Don't take him to school. Don't take him to work. Don't take him into the voting booth. Don't take him into politics. Keep him out of everything. Be passionate about anything else, but don't be passionate about God. I can be passionate about the movies. I can be passionate about sports. I can be passionate about politics. I can be passionate about fashion and clothes. I can be passionate about restaurants. And I'd say a lot of us are. But I cannot be passionate about God. That one's a no-no. If you were to type the phrase, a passion for, in your computer to Google, you would find a couple of hundred book titles show up on the list. I did it. There's a book called A Passion for Birds, A Passion for Books, A Passion for Cactus, A Passion for Chocolate. Not one I would buy, but many of you probably would. I hate chocolate. I would do A Passion for Caramel. There's books for a passion for fashion, for fishing, for flying, for gardening, for golfing, for hunting. There's even a book called A Passion for Mushrooms. I think they're smoking them, not eating them. I'm a 70s kid, all right? There's a passion for needlepoint, a passion for pasta, ponies. There's a book called A Passion for Potatoes. There's even a book, A Passion for Steam. I can't figure out what that one's all about. Why would anybody get steamed up over steam? This boggles my mind. But in our culture, it's okay to be passionate about anything except our faith, except our relationship with God. We can go to a rock concert, political rally, baseball game. We can shout our fool head off. We can get excited. We can get hoarse from yelling so loud. When my team loses, I can cry. Nobody thinks that's a big deal. When my team wins, I can jump up and down and dance and wave my hands, and everybody in the crowd is just simply going to say, hey, there's a real fan. But if I get a little excited in church, it's like, you're weird. He's a fanatic. He's a nut job. You don't want to get too emotional about your faith. It's okay with anything else, but not your faith. Listen to what Paul writes in Romans 12:1. Never be lacking in zeal. Zeal. But keep your spiritual fervor. Keep the fire going in your life. There's a passage in the Bible that says, if there's just an ember that's smoldering, give God permission and He'll fan it into a flame. But notice the word in Romans 12:1. If you do these things in the Bible, circle it, highlight it, the word keep. See, Paul wants us to understand passion is not automatic. Passion is a choice. It's a discipline. It's something that must be maintained. We are not by nature passionate about God. It's something we must choose to do. We get distracted. And quite honestly, folks, about everything in life conspires to keep us from being passionate about God. So he says, keep your passion going. Keep the fire going. It's a discipline. It is not automatic. This kind of thing, being passionate about God, has nothing to do with our personality or our age either, by the way. Our church is filled with believers who have walked with God for a long, long time. And many of you are still very, very passionate. Billy Graham is 95 years old. He will be 96 this fall. He is still passionate about winning people to Jesus Christ. His health does not allow him to leave his home hardly at all anymore, but he does struggle to go up to the center that's right there where he lives And he preaches a sermon every day, almost, all right, to the guests who come there, to the staff who's there. He gives a short devotion when he can. He was the brain behind the My Hope campaign last year. He wanted one more chance. He knew he couldn't preach in a big platform anymore, but through a DVD, he could get the message of Jesus Christ out. Billy Graham is still passionate about people he has never seen or met before coming to know Jesus Christ. Because he understands if we don't win them to Christ, we have lost them to Satan. He never lets up. It has nothing to do with your age. It has nothing to do with your personality. Quiet and introverted people can still be passionate. Everything in life conspires to keep us from being passionate. It dissipates our energy like helium in a balloon. If you let a balloon go in your house, you didn't hold on to it, and it gets stuck on the ceiling. We often wonder how we're going to get it down. Us men, we know how. Where's the pellet gun? Okay. But the ladies, the wives say, no, just, you know, by tomorrow, it'll come down. Usually it doesn't even take that long. By evening, it's lost its, and it comes to the ground. It's lost its zip and its zest. It's often a picture of us. We lose our enthusiasm. What happens? Why does this happen? And that's what we're going to look at this morning. As we go through God's Word, we're going to look at 7 passion killers. Things that rob the joy and the zest out of our life. So we're going to look at these passion killers. I want you to use it kind of as a checklist. Maybe allow the Spirit to speak to you and say, yeah, that's one I need to deal with. Because God says, I want you to love me with all of my heart. And passion also heats things up, and I'm getting hot in here. I don't know about the rest of you. All right, number one. First of the passion killers, an unbalanced schedule. That means either you're overworked or you're underworked. And either or, you're going to lose your passion for life and you'll lose your passion for God. You see, life is a series of seasons, the Bible says. The book of Ecclesiastes, there is a time for everything. There is a rhythm to life and to death. And we need both. We need input and we need output. We need both rest and work. And too much of either will cause us to lose our passion. Too much work, we lose our passion. Too much nothing, boredom, that will cause us to lose our passion. My guess is, in a crowd this size, half of you need to work less. Half of you need to work more. I'm not saying all y'all. You're with me. All right. But it's probably true. We're all different in our personalities. And we can go to either extreme. Psalm 127 says it this way. It's senseless for you to work so hard from early morning till late at night, fearing that you're going to starve to death. For God wants his loved ones to get proper rest. That's a good verse for your refrigerator door. God wants you to get proper rest. Some of you, the problem is you're always giving out. You're always helping. You're always sharing. You're always serving. You're always working. You're always being generous. And you never take time to recharge. If you never take time to recharge, then we get unbalanced on the ministry side, on the work side. We're going to eventually experience compassion fatigue, burnout. We stop caring. We don't care about God anymore. We don't care about other people anymore. We don't care about ministry anymore. Why? Because we have given too much out and we've not taken enough in. When you care and care and care and care, eventually you will experience compassion fatigue. Others of you here, you're the exact opposite. You're always taking in, never giving out. You go to Bible studies, you listen to teachers on the radio, you listen to tapes, you go to seminars, you go to Christian concerts, you go to workshops, you come to church all the time, every time the doors are open, you're always learning, you're always taking in, you're always growing on the input, but you are not giving out any. You don't have ministry, you don't have a mission, you don't know what your purpose in life is, you're not helping anybody except yourself. You're taking in all this food, and you're spiritually getting fatter and fatter and fatter until pretty soon we're going to have to roll you down the aisle to your spot in the pew. And that's where the church gets the term holy rollers from. You're taking in all of the time and you are never giving out. And I don't know which one is your problem. But my guess, we have some of both here. Too much output, not enough input. Too much input, not enough output. You've got to let the Holy Spirit help you decide that. I'm sure God is able. Let me give you a little shock. Bible study without ministry is extremely dangerous. Bible study without ministry is extremely dangerous. Here's why. And the half-brother of Jesus wrote in his letter to the church, James chapter 2, verse 17, to him or her who knows to do good and who does it, does not, it is sin. Does it get much more simple than that? If you know the good that should be done and you don't do it, it's just like adultery, lying, stealing. It's sin. Wow. And do you realize the more that you know about God's plan from all of your Bible study, the more responsible you are to God for the knowledge that you now have? You're increasing your responsibility with the intake without any output. Because God holds us accountable for what we know, and the Bible says we need both in life, inflow and outgo. We need to work and we need to rest. We need balance in our schedule. Here's the antidote for Paul in 1 Timothy 4, 7 when he says, take the time and the trouble to keep yourself spiritually fit. It won't be easy. I love the way Paul phrased it here. Take the time, but it's also going to be trouble. It doesn't come easy. Take time and trouble to stay fit. That's part of the reason we're going to do a series for 6 weeks in the middle of summer. All right? 40 days to a healthier you. Balance is a key word here. We all know that to be physically fit, we must have a balanced diet. To be spiritually fit, we must have a balance of God's purposes for our life in our life. We need to have time to worship with God, both privately and corporately. We need to have times when we're fellowshipping with unbelievers. We need to have times when we're alone, reading the Word, letting God speak to us, and growing as one of His kids. We need to have time of ministry and service when we're giving out and using our abilities. And we need times of mission when we are sharing our faith with others. If you tend to go to seed on one of these purposes, you have a lot of fellowship but nothing else, or a lot of Bible study and nothing else, you're going to end up imbalanced. You will inevitably lose your passion. You're going to go, how come I don't feel as close to God as I used to? It's because you're out of balance. Number one reason. Number two killer. What time is it? Okay, ooh, we got to go. An unused talent will cause you to lose your passion for your life and your passion for God. Did I tell you what it was? Did I tell you what number two was?
No.
An unused talent. Unused talent. 1 Peter 4:10 says, each of you, who's left out? Nobody. Each of you has been blessed with one of God's many wonderful gifts to be used in the service of others. So use your gifts well. God gives talents, abilities, personality that shape you. He's given to you those gifts and those talents. Use them for the benefit of His kingdom and for other people. My gifts are for your service. Your gifts are for my benefit. We are to use those gifts in the service for others. God has given us a special role in this world, and He wants us to make a contribution with our life. God says, I've given you these gifts. Don't waste them. If you don't use your talents, you will lose your passion. God did not give you special abilities just to sit on them and do nothing about it. God says, I want you to use it or you're going to lose it. I don't even need to preach this sermon. Let me get very specific. If you are stuck in a job that does not use any of your talents to any degree at all, you are going to lose your zeal and your zest and your passion for life. You will experience burnout. Studies have shown that 70% of all Americans are in a job that does not use their talent at all. That is tragic. And I think that even makes God sad. Because God did not give us talents and then say, don't use them, just go make money. There's something more important than money, and that is using what God has given to us. 1 Corinthians 7 says, each one of you should live his life with the gifts the Lord has given. God gave us gifts and abilities. Let's use them. The reality is we're never going to find a job that uses 100% of our talent. We're never going to find a job that is 100% fulfilling. And there's a reason for that. God never meant for us to find our fulfillment just in our job. Our life is more than our employment. He wants us to have ministry. That's why we need a ministry in our church to use the talents that we're not using on the job. Because no job could possibly use all the talent that God has provided for us. We need a job. We need a ministry that expresses what we are good at. There's a third cause for the loss of passion in our lives. Unconfessed sin. This is a big one. Few things rob us of joy, rob us of confidence, rob us of passion more quickly than guilt. Here's how this works with us with guilt. We don't walk around thinking, oh, I have sin in my life. I'm guilty. No, we rationalize some behavior that we've been engaged in. We say to ourselves, well, everybody else does that. Well, well, I know so-and-so did that. But when things are quiet, when things are still, when nothing else is going on, all of a sudden, condemnation creeps into our life. Guilt pops up. Subconsciously, right now, as I'm talking about an unconfessed sin, I suspect something jumped in your mind. I suspect. Here's the truth about us human beings. We cannot experience enthusiasm and guilt at the same time. We will not experience passion and guilt at the same time. Because guilt, by its very definition, robs us of passion. Here is what David, after the sin with Bathsheba, wrote in Psalm 38, 4 and 6. He says, "My guilt has overwhelmed me like a burden that is too heavy to bear. I am bowed down and I am brought low." A lot of us work on computers. Have you ever had your computer crash? Yeah. They stop working. Guilt does that to us human beings. We are not made to live with guilt. God did not make us to carry guilt around. He made us to deal with it immediately. He sent Jesus to this world to die on a cross to say, "I want to offer you a gift, a life freed from guilt." That is God's gift. Paul says it this way, "There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus." Quit carrying the guilties around. But some of you right now, you're in the midst of a personal system crash. Truth of the matter is, the joy in your life has crashed. And you're trying to keep the enthusiasm up. You're trying to keep the passion alive. But the guilt keeps crashing the system. So what do? Fortunately, this is an easy fix. It can be remedied quickly. You can do this right now. You don't have to wait till the sermon is over, because Jesus has already done all that's needed to be done with our guilt. That's why he came to this earth. 1 John 1:9 says, "If we confess our sins, he, God, can be trusted to forgive us our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness." That is his promise. If we confess, he forgives. "God, I agree with you. I've sinned. Thank you for your forgiveness." That's how we get rid of guilt. We acknowledge it. I would encourage you, do it right now. Don't wait. Sometimes we carry guilt around for days or weeks or months. You shouldn't carry it around even for 1 hour. The minute we realize that red warning light is flashing in our head saying, "Sin, sin, confess it," God will remove the guilt from you. There's a fourth cause for a loss of passion in our lives. It's unresolved conflict. Conflict just drains the passion right out of us. If you ever start a day and you just know it's going to be a great day, you fly out of bed, you're awake from the moment you get up, you're ready for the day, shower, breakfast, man, you are on your way out the door, and as you go out, your spouse starts an argument. Ever happened to you? Okay? Hadn't happened to me in 7 years. To a pastor, if that's going to happen, it's going to happen on a Sunday morning. Okay? I just leave an hour and a half before she ever wakes up. Man, or parents, maybe it's not your spouse. Man, on the way here, your kids get in a fight in the back seat. Huh? That ever happened to y'all? Yeah. All the zip goes right out of your doodah. All right? It's just like the air going out of a tire when the conflicts come. That's what conflict does. It takes the passion out. Our attitude all of a sudden just goes flat. Let's be honest about this. Some of you, you're in a situation at home or at work where conflict is constant. Maybe you're even doing all you can to minimize the conflict, but it's coming from the other person. How do you keep your passion in a situation like that? You must decide to protect yourself from three passion-killing emotions that can come into our lives in the midst of conflict. You cannot control the other person, but we can control the kind of emotions that we will have in the midst of the conflict. Those three emotions that kill our passion in the midst of conflict are resentment, jealousy, and prolonged anger. And Job gives us two verses that deals with all three of those. Job 5:2 says, "Resentment destroys the fool, and jealousy kills the simple." Circle those words, resentment, jealousy, passion-killing emotions. Job 18:4 says, "You are only hurting yourself with your anger." Circle anger. It only hurts you. We make the decision when it comes to resentment, jealousy, and prolonged anger to hold on to it or let it go. This is why forgiveness is so very important. God, who knows us, who made us, who created us, knows we were not designed to carry resentment. So he says, here's a way to let it go. Even logically, we know that resentment that we have in our lives is not hurting the person that we're resentful against. Quite frankly, most of us know they don't even know we're resentful. It's hurting us, and the anger is killing us. If you want the passion restored to your heart, to your life, to your relationships, forgive. Let it go. I know what some of you are thinking. Let them off the hook? You think I'm going to let them off the hook? How can I do that? Folks, I'm not telling you to let them off the hook. What I'm telling you is, put them on God's hook. Tear the hook in your life away. Throw it away. Put them on God's hook. Let him deal with them. God can handle them better than you can. You forgive. Leave the rest up to God. There's a fifth cause for the loss of passion. An unsupported lifestyle. Sometimes we lose passion for God because we're not spending time around other people who have a passion for God. Ecclesiastes 4, 9 through 10, some very common sense truth from the Bible. Two are better than one because if one falls down, his friend can help him up. But pity the man who falls and has no one to help him up. We need each other. We fall at times. We stumble at times. We need people to help us in our lives. That is why we need small groups. It's why it's so important. Those of you who have thought many times, maybe, well, I should do that. Maybe this will be the day that you realize I'm going to do that, because if you wait till the day that a crisis comes in your life, it's too late to join a small group to help you with that crisis because you have no relationship with them whatsoever. That's the benefit. We're there to help each other up. But it's not only for the difficult times, it's also for the good times. Human beings were made for relationships. We're made to live that way. In prison, when they want to give somebody the ultimate punishment in prison, where do they send them? Solitary confinement, because we were made to be with others. That's how God created us. Whether we're married or single, we need relationships with others. Others who are trying to live with passion of God in their lives. Keep the passion. Keep it real in life. Having been a pastor for a while, I've seen a lot of people continue with their passion for God. I have also seen a lot of people lose their passion for God. Those that lose their passion, there's a very predictable pattern. You can see it the same almost every time. Here's how the pattern begins. The first thing that happens is the person stops coming to church consistently. I'm not talking about the ritual of coming to church. I'm talking about the fact they draw back from the relationships of other believers in the fellowship. There's a lot of reasons we tell ourselves that it's okay. It's summer. I'll watch on the internet, sporting events. I've got other things to do. I'll get back to it soon. But whatever the reason, we start not spending time with other people who have the same passion that we need. The next thing that always seems to happen in our hearts is it starts to turn cold. We start to feel distant from God. We start to sense that God is far from us. What we really need is to be around other people who can warm up that love that we have for God in our life. It's a need in all of us around us that other people who have passion for God can stir up in us. If we have no inspiring contact with other believers, our heart will grow cold. It is inevitable. Hebrews 10, 24 through 25 says, let us consider how we may spur one another towards love and good deeds. Let's not give up meeting together, but let's go on encouraging one another. The sixth purpose killer is an unclear purpose. When we forget the purpose of our life, our passion is sure to die away. Whenever we forget why God put us on earth, we begin to drift towards apathy or lethargy. Passion and purpose go together. When we have a clear purpose, it's going to give our life passion. Hobbes wrote about passion when he said, passion is waking up in the morning where you are, bounding out of bed because you know there's something out there you love to do, that you believe in, that God made you for and you're good at, something that's bigger than you are and you can hardly wait to do it again. It's something you'd rather be doing than anything else, and you wouldn't give it up for money because it means more to you than money. Nothing matters more than knowing that we are living in the purpose and the passion that God has placed us on this earth. And last of all, the last killer of passion is an undernourished spirit. An undernourished spirit will kill our passion. Every day, we face all kinds of circumstances that conspire to shrink and shrivel our hearts. We're going to get up tomorrow morning. We're going to have some distractions and disappointments. We're going to have some conflicts. We're going to have some changes and challenges. We're going to have problems and pressures. We're going to have frustrations and fears and failures and fatigue. And all of these things fall in on us to shrivel our hearts and to shrink our spirit. So we must intentionally nourish our soul. If we don't do it, nobody else is going to do it for us. So if we don't take the time and the trouble to do it, we are going to shrivel up. Maintaining passion is not something that happens automatically. Passion is not a feeling, you see. It's a decision. It's a series of decisions that fuels an ongoing love affair. Just because I told Shelley that I loved her 7 years ago and wanted to spend the rest of my life with her, that was not enough. Every single day, the passion in this relationship must be recharged and refueled. And that doesn't mean there are times that we don't bump heads. It doesn't mean there are times that we don't want to say, "You make me so mad." But there must be time we spend together to recharge each other's passion for each other. And it has to be a willful decision. You can't just let it go. So how do we do this? I got to wrap this up in 3 minutes. At least 5 purposes. One, we need times of worship with God every day. Private times where we tell God, "I love you. I love you." You tell God every single day, "I love you." Number two, we need fellowship with other believers. We need to hear other believers telling God they love Him too. That encourages us. Number three, we need to read God's Word and grow in the knowledge of Him. Because as we read His Word, we get to hear God say to us, "I love you." Bless you. Number four, we need to have a ministry where we are using our talents with other people. You got Sunday school. You got worship. You got homeless. You got mission outreaches. You got men's ministries. You got visiting those who were sick. You got seeing the shut-in. Does it fit you? Then God's going to create one for you. Come up with it. Figure it out. We need a mission in the world where we're sharing our faith. If we just choose one of the purposes and we forget the others, we're going to be imbalanced and we're going to lose our passion. We need them all. Number five, if you didn't get it, was we need a mission in the world where we're sharing our faith. So how do we do it? How do we plug into God? How does this thing become a vital daily relationship that keeps our spirit nourished? The starting point is to remember how God feels about you. To realize that God is passionate about you. God is hopelessly in love with you. God sent His Son to die on a cross. And His Son, when He stretched out His arms, said, "I would rather die than live without you." That is His passion for us. In fact, the suffering of Jesus on the cross, it's described as the passion. You've probably heard about communities or towns. There's one in Arkansas that does the Passion Play. What is a Passion Play? It's the drama that depicts the suffering of Jesus Christ. Jesus never wanted us to forget what He did for us on the cross. He gave us the symbol of communion as an ongoing reminder. Remember this. Let me close with this verse. Acts 1:3 says, Jesus showed Himself alive to them, the disciples, after His passion. By many demonstrations, after His passion, after His death on the cross, referred to in the Bible as the Passion, He showed Himself in many demonstrations. For 40 days, He continued to appear to them and tell them about the kingdom of God. Do you see how passionate Jesus was for us? He died on a cross. He said, "I'd rather die than live without you." You see how passionate He hung around on this earth for 40 days after He could have already been in heaven with His Father. And he confronted each one of His remaining disciples. Why? Because He loved them, and through them His Word would reach to you and 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 to me. 40 days. 40 days. Do you realize how many days it was since you and I celebrated Easter this year? It's been 28 days. Do you realize if this was 2,000 years ago, Jesus would have still been in our midst. He'd be here for 12 more days because of His passion for us. Which one of those passion killers, which ones of those passion killers has crept into your life? Let's pray. Father, maybe the biggest passion killer is the preacher who preaches too long. But Father, I pray Your Spirit made us think that it was just a 15-minute sermon instead of a 45-minute sermon. Father, what I'm most concerned about is
for your Spirit to have the freedom to speak to our spirits today, to accomplish in us only the things that you can do. May you find in many who are here today a willingness to choose to have passion in their hearts with you. And let that passion that's in them be expressed through the ministry and care to the world. In Jesus' name we pray.